Welcome back. By now we are familiar with the vertical horizontal binary alternative for the polarization qubit. In this lecture, we will learn about two more ways of looking at the polarization qubit. So we have seen in the previous lectures that if we begin with a photon source that emits photons of any kind of polarization, then we have optical elements, finally we probe the photons arriving at the end of the experiment by a polarizing beam splitter, which sorts the photons into vertically polarized photons and horizontally polarized photons, and we detect each kind with a detector. So at the end of the experiment, the photon that just went through makes either this detector click or it makes this detector click, and that's our signal. Now, we describe the photons by two component columns, with the upper amplitude referring to the vertical polarization and the lower amplitude referring to the horizontal polarization. And usually these columns will be normalized such that alpha squared plus beta squared equals 1. And the meaning of these squares of complex numbers is that this alpha squared is the probability of getting a click of the vertically of the detector for the vertically polarized photons, and the beta squared is the probability of detecting a horizontally polarized photon, provided that just before this polarizing beam splitter, the column alpha beta describes the incoming photon. Now, on the way from the source to the photon, we can have various optical elements, and we have seen what some of them do. Some of them select vertical polarization, and that would be described by this 2x2 matrix. We can also select horizontal polarization, then we use this 2x2 matrix to describe the optical element. Or we can have a half-wave plate set at 45 degrees, which converts horizontal polarization into vertical polarization, and vertical polarization into horizontal polarization. This is described by a 2x2 matrix of this kind. We can also do nothing, in which case we have the 2x2 unit matrix that describes what's going on, namely nothing is going on. So right now, these dots between the source and the polarizing beam splitter at the final measurement, they just stand for any sequence of the optical elements that are represented by V selection, A selection, flipper, or the do nothing. And the overall description would be a sequence of matrices multiply together in the same order in which the optical elements are placed here. So we first have the column, and then we have in the order in which the optical elements appear here, we have the matrices written and multiplied together and multiplying the column to produce the final column that is then probed by the horizon beam splitter. The flipper, as we said, is a half-wave plate set at 45 degrees, and it converts vertically polarized photons into horizontally polarized photons. Now, if we set the half-wave plate at any other angle, it doesn't turn this polarization by 90 degrees, it turns it by another angle. So, for example, if we set the half-wave plate at 22.5 degrees, half of 45 degrees, then the vertical polarized photons are converted into linear polarized photons in this diagonal direction, and the horizontally polarized photons are converted into photons in this diagonal direction, the anti-diagonal direction. So, let's remember that the vertically polarized photons would be described by a column which is 1, 0, so that stands for the vertically polarized photons. The horizontally polarized photons are described by a column 0, 1, so that's for the horizontally polarized photons. Now, these diagonal polarizations, they are halfway between vertical and horizontal, and as we know from classical optics, we get them by having equal weight superpositions of vertically polarized and horizontally polarized light. So for this diagonal, the equal weight superposition will be in phase, and we have 1 and 1 for the column entries. And here they are out of phase, so we have 1 and minus 1. If we want to have these columns properly normalized such that the alpha squared and beta squared add up to 1, we should divide by the square root of 2. So let's do that. And we have normalized columns. And then this would be the column that is for the anti-diagonal polarization. And this is the column for the diagonal linear polarization. And as I said, setting the half-wave plate at any other angle gives you linear polarization in any other direction in this picture. What else can we do? Well, rather than using half-wave plates, we can use quarter-wave plates. And a quarter-wave plate converts vertically polarized photons into photons that are polarized in the right-hand circular way, right-hand circular polarization, and the horizontally polarized photons will be converted into photons which are circularly polarized in the left-handed way. So again, these are equal weight superpositions of vertical and horizontal, but now not in phase or completely out of phase, but with a phase in between, half a phase which is not zero or 180 degrees, which is not zero or pi, but pi half. So the columns that we get are 1i and 1 minus i. Again, we divide by a square root of 2 for proper normalization. And then we have these columns describing photons that are polarized in the right-handed circular way, and these are photons that are circularly polarized, but they are left-handed. So we began with the binary alternative between vertical and horizontal polarization, but now we also have the binary alternative between diagonal and anti-diagonal polarization, and the binary alternative between right-handed and left-handed circular polarization. So each of them is sort of alternatives for the same polarization qubit. Now, what are the values that we assign to that? Well, it would be standard to assign the value plus 1 to vertical polarization and minus 1 to horizontal polarization. But please remember that these are arbitrary choices that we could also change and opt for other values if we find the other values more convenient. But let's just stick to plus 1 and minus 1. So we are looking for a mathematical object that for vertical polarization has the value plus 1 and for horizontal polarization has the value minus 1. I will tell you what that is. Okay? It's a matrix which is 1, 0, 0, minus 1. That matrix we will call Z. And so let's just check in which sense this has the value plus 1 and minus 1 for vertical and horizontal polarization. If I take the Z matrix and I process a vertically polarized photon by it, then it just reproduces the column, yeah, and does nothing else. If, however, I apply the matrix to the column describing a horizontally polarized photon, then I get minus 1 at the bottom rather than plus 1, which is the original column multiplied by minus 1. And this we now read as the original column multiplied by plus 1. So for this column, this matrix has eigenvalue plus 1, and for this column, this matrix has eigenvalue minus 1. So when we say that Z matrix, or that Z property described by this matrix has value plus 1 and minus 1 for vertical and horizontal polarization, then that just means in this mathematical formalism that we have these eigenvalues plus one and minus one for the corresponding columns. All right, so now what is the analog for the diagonal polarizations? What is the matrix such that it has eigenvalue plus one for diagonal polarization and minus one for the anti-diagonal polarization? This matrix we call X, perhaps reminiscent of the two diagonal polarizations, and it has this form 0, 1, 1, 0. Let's check. Okay, so we begin with the matrix. We apply it to diagonal polarization, which is 1, 1. We don't need to keep track of the square root of 2 right now. And this is 1, 1 as the result of this multiplication. And if we take the X matrix, apply it to the column for anti-diagonal polarization, then we get minus 1 and 1, which is the original column multiplied by minus 1, such as this is the original column multiplied by plus 1. So yes, this X is eigenvalue plus 1 for diagonal polarization and eigenvalue minus 1 for anti-diagonal polarization. Then, having seen these particular matrices that have values plus 1 and minus 1 for the vertical horizontal binary alternative and for the diagonal anti-diagonal alternative, what about right-handed and left-handed circular polarization? Well, here we also have such a matrix. It's called Y, and it has this form. Let's verify. So we begin with the Y matrix. We apply it to right-handed circular polarization. Again, we don't need to keep track of the 1 over square root of 2. And what we get is the matrix this column reproduced. So yes, there is eigenvalue plus 1. And if we take the Y matrix and apply it to the column for left-handed circular polarization, then we get the column minus 1 and I. And that is the original column 1 minus I multiplied by minus 1. So indeed, this Y matrix describes the property that assigns plus 1 to right-handed circular polarization and minus 1 to left-handed circular polarization. And so we now have these matrices X, Y, and Z, which very often are referred to as Pauli matrices. And they describe the binary properties, the binary alternatives that we associate with vertical or horizontal, diagonal or anti-diagonal, right-handed or left-handed polarization. In summary, we have recognized that there are three equivalent ways of looking at the polarization qubit. We can view it as the binary alternative between vertical and horizontal polarization, or diagonal or anti-diagonal polarization, or right-handed and left-handed polarization. For each of the three choices, we have a Pauli matrix with eigenvalues plus 1 and minus 1. In the next lecture, we will recognize that these three choices refer to one more abstract underlying notion.